here this morning, it's always good to have fellowship, be able to visit. But if you are visiting with us this morning, we're so glad that you're here. I just want to welcome you to the services at Lane Christian Church. And I just want to begin by drawing your attention to the bulletin that you picked up when you came in the door. On the edge of that bulletin is a little perforated flap we call it the connection card. If you wouldn't mind, please filling that out for us, just so we can have a record of your attendance here with us today. And if you would, put it in the offering plate, which is just to the left of the double doors here. And if you are visiting with us, that's the only thing we want you to put in that plate, as we do this time together as our gift to you. Now, on the back side of that, there's something there for everybody. It is a place for prayer requests. Being a praying church, we'd love to have the opportunity to pray with you and to pray for you. So you can put your prayer requests there. It's also a place, if you have any updates to anything that is currently on our prayer list, that way we can keep everybody up to date about what is going on and the things that we need to be praying for. Now, as far as announcements go this morning, have a few of them. Youth group tonight here at 5:30 at the church for our junior hires and our high schoolers. And where is April? April, there she is. She's got an update for us on the bazaar.
It's October finally! Woo! We've been working all year with our crafting, and now it's time to work with our food. I'm going to have a sign-up sheet. If you would like to make some food to sell, we have to make it in our kitchen. And I thought, you know, if you had a certain day that you had to, that was the only time you could do it, we could sign up for it, and then the kitchen would be available for you then. There's a sign-up sheet outside here in the gathering area, and it is for lunch food. So we need buns, chips, drinks, just bottles of water. So you buy a, you know, a 24 thing of water. That would be good. Those are items that we need for our lunch that we're going to sell. So if you don't cook and you don't have time or anything, that maybe that's one way that you can contribute. And we're also going to have a meeting right up here after church. I'm going to ignite, so be patient with me. I'll try to get here as soon as I can. And we're going to talk to the crafters, the cookers, and the workers. So if everybody can come and help, you know, that has any of those jobs, come and we'll talk with you. Okay?
All right. Well, and I made this announcement last week, but it gets to go around this week. We are at the beginning of another quarter, which means the clipboards for cleaning and hospitality and our greeters get to get passed around again. So last week I started it on this side, so this week I'm going to start it over here on this side. And hopefully they can make their way all the way around before we get to the end of the service. Any other announcements? Okay, I have one more, and this would, oh, Susan.
Good morning. Will you stand with us while we pray?
To our time of praise and or prayer requests and both. So begin this morning. Any praises this morning for the things that have happened the past few weeks? Yes.
I have one. My dad, Jim Ball, yes. Was on the list for being hospitalized, but he came home on Thursday. Mm-hmm. So So he's home. He's doing better. Still has lots of follow-ups and everything, but doing much better. So thank you for the prayers.
Yes, absolutely. We are glad to see that Jim is home and doing better. Any other praises? Yes.
My mom turns 99 on Tuesday, so I want to say that's a praise and a blessing.
99.
99.
Wow. your mom is an amazing woman.
Yes.
All right, so praises for birthday, praises for getting out of the hospital. Any other praises? Roger.
I spoke to Larry Hope, and he is doing better. He's still doing therapy. He had a stroke here a couple of weeks ago. He's making progress.
All right. Any other? Yeah, Denny.
For my brother Kenny, he had some more issues first of the week, and he ended up in St. John's in Springfield with some ability not to speak, but from Friday till yesterday, 1,000,000,000 turnaround.
Wow.
All over the world. He can speak. Him and his wife Joyce can battle together, you know, back and forth.
That's a good thing.
Praise the Lord for
absolutely
what he is today.
Yep. All right. Awesome praises. Am I? Guess it helped. I turned it on. I'll take the blame for that one. Any other praises? Prayer requests. Any prayer requests from Deb?
Yeah, our friend Chris Green went for her second opinion, and his second opinion was keep the course with the doctor down here, which was very reassuring to her. And that she can continue with cataract surgery and things like that that she put on hold. And we need
to continue to pray that she can tolerate her chemo. Yes. All right. Any other prayer requests? Yeah. Absolutely. Yep. Okay. I've got one more, and we've texted messaged back and forth about it. Debbie, have you found anybody to help get you to your next set of appointments?
Not yet.
Okay, so what is the date on that? October the...
We have to leave next Sunday the 9th.
The 9th.
I just need taken up there. You don't have to stay the whole week. I got to ride home.
Okay.
I just need to ride up to Rochester, Minnesota.
Okay. So if anybody is available to run her up and drop her off, that would be greatly appreciated. Any other praises, prayer requests, anything else? All right. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just thank you for this day of life. We just thank you for this time that we have to gather together here this morning to praise you, to worship you, to celebrate the praises that we have, God. You are so good for working in our lives, for those that have had medical issues that we've seen get to come home from the hospital, for those that have had medical issues that have seen turnarounds. God, we thank you and we give you the glory. God, for those that are going through life transitions, God, we think about Nick and Jess and the kids and Johnny and Janelle and others that are going through huge life transitions that can be exciting but can be challenging as well, that you would just, that you would be at work in those situations, that you would make those transitions as smooth as possible, that what needs to be done there can be done. And Lord, just for the way that you work in our lives, God, we just We give you the honor, we give you the praise and the glory. We know in this life sometimes we don't get the answers that we want. We don't necessarily get them when we want them or the like. But we know that you are God and we know that you're good. And for that, we look to you for all things in life. For those blessings, we are grateful, but most importantly for your Son, Jesus, through whom we have the opportunity for salvation and eternal life. And it's in his powerful name we pray all these things. Amen. All right. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I'm going to have you open up to a passage of Scripture that you probably don't even need your Bible for. If you're following along in a sanctuary Bible, it is page 458. This is one of those passages of Scripture that it doesn't matter whether you are a Christian, whether you go to church, it is a passage of Scripture that you know. And chances are, if you are like me, you know it out of the King James Version of the Bible, because that's what we all learned it out of as kids. So here it is, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The 23rd Psalm. A picture of God's love, of God's grace and mercy and compassion through the trials that we face in life. Penned by David, this man after God's own heart, who himself was familiar with all the types of grief and struggle and trial that the world can throw at a person. Now, to begin with this morning, I'm going to share a little bit of my story. And it's part of my story that I do not look back on with any amount of fondness. My first ministry experience could be defined in a single word: miserable. Oh, you can ask him about it. She could share about it too. We walked that path together. I get out of high school, not quite sure what I want to do with my life, so I decide that I'm going to go to Bible college for a year just to check it out. And one of those reasons is, well, I did a couple of them there preacher boy competitions when I was in high school, and I had a little bit of scholarship money. And Mom and Dad were kind of after me. I'd call it nagging. They'd call it encouragement to do something. And so I decided to do something. So I go off to Bible college, and I'm there for about 6 months, and I'm like, yeah, this is what I'm supposed to do. I don't know about the rest of you guys in here, but I kind of went through that phase growing up of, I want to be just like my dad, and I don't want to be anything like my dad, because my dad was a preacher. But I discovered that that's what I'm supposed to be doing. And so, I go through all 4 years of college, start preaching my freshman year, get down towards the end of my senior year. By this time, Kim and I are dating. We're getting ready for graduation. We're planning a wedding. Kind of a side note, but a word of encouragement. Don't try to do all of those things at once. Graduate from college, get married, start a new ministry in a grand total of an 8-day time span. It's crazy insane. Now, I got to April, and I started interviewing with this church. It's a church that had contacted me and said, hey, we're looking for a preacher, and we were given your name. Would you come interview with us? So I did. I interviewed with them, and I interviewed with them for 6 weeks. I was excited. Now, I had had a couple of part-time ministries in college, and they were great experiences, but I was ready to get out and rock the world for Jesus. Man, was I naive. So, we get through school, we graduate, Kim and I get married, spend a week in Colorado on honeymoon, come back, and the ministry begins. Now, I will spare just put it this way. By the time July rolled around, we were beginning to seriously question our decision. By the time I concluded that ministry 11 months later, I was convinced I didn't want to do ministry anymore. I had several long conversations with God about how I didn't sign up for this. Now, I'm older now. I'm a little more seasoned, and I do realize that, yeah, there were some decisions that I made during those days that probably weren't the best, but it was a situation that we walked into where a church was on the verge of imploding and we didn't know it. So I questioned it. Why did this happen? What is the purpose behind it? I didn't sign up for this. So what do? Well, Kim and I decided, well, we wanted to go to seminary, so we were going to do that. But married student housing wasn't open at LCU, so I spent 3 months as a welder and driving a forklift working for my father-in-law. And again, those conversations continued. And oftentimes, I hate to admit it, they were one-way conversations about how I didn't want to do this anymore and I didn't sign up to be treated that way. But God worked on me. I'll be honest. I found it hard to walk into a church building. Went to church with my in-laws, you walk through the front door and you get that sick feeling in your stomach. If you've ever had a bad experience with the church, you know what I'm talking about. That church that we went to didn't do anything to us, hadn't hurt us, but yet it was still a struggle. But you know, through it all, God was good. God carried us. God showed us. Though I would never want to relive that experience ever again, today, looking back on it, I'm grateful for it. I learned more about ministry in real life in that 11 months than I did over 4 years in Bible college. Kim and I were newlyweds, very newlyweds, and to have a challenge like that could do one of two things. It could destroy your marriage or it could make it stronger. Well, we're living in this little town, hours from the closest family member, so all you have is each other. And so even in the midst of the chaos, there were blessings to be had. Why I share this goes with our dumb thing for this morning. This crazy thing, this dumb thing that smart Christians believe, and it is simply this, that a valley in your life means that you made a wrong turn. That if you are experiencing something that is negative, that you are experiencing a challenge, you have somehow veered off the path that you're supposed to be on. That's crazy. So where do we get this idea that a valley is a wrong term? Well, I think it comes from the idea that every valley we face is a negative. And since negative equals bad, then valley equals bad. We think the only place that God ever leads us to is the mountaintop. This idea is prevalent in the church and in our culture, and the consequences of such a mindset can be absolutely devastating. Why? Because it causes us at a fundamental level to question the goodness of God, to question the love of God, the grace of God, the mercy of God, all of those attributes that we are called to emulate in our own lives, to show love, to show grace, to show mercy. When we question that in God, how well do you think we're going to be able to extend it to others? Not very well. The great revivalist and evangelist Billy Graham made this observation. We love the mountaintops, but fruit doesn't grow on top of the mountains. And how true it is. Oh, we may struggle with the valleys. We may not like the valleys. But the valleys are the places that produce that fruit. So key thought for the morning. We're all going to have times when we're forced to walk through a valley. It's as sure as death and taxes. How we respond is what makes the difference. How do we respond to those situations? Sometimes our responses are good. Sometimes our responses are not so good. But the key point is how we initially respond may not be the end of the story for us. You ever hear of a thing called a knee-jerk reaction? We're good at them, aren't we? It is experience reaction, experience reaction. And sometimes those initial reactions are not tempered with grace, are not tempered with love, are not tempered with mercy. It's kind of like a first impression. Sometimes we make a great first impression, other times we don't. Because it's things in life that we have to work on. If a valley doesn't necessarily mean a wrong term, then what does it mean? Well, valleys come in all shapes and sizes, and no two of them are the same. Some immediately have the end in sight, others seem as if they will plague us for eternity. Some are self-inflicted, while others result because we reside in a corrupted world, while others are obviously bearing out the will of God, which we may not understand until it is over. Hey, Ed, when that pops up, it'll keep recording.
Okay.
So anyway, when we get down to it, we consider the question, how in the world do we end up in these valleys? And I will point this out. David, as he talks, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he doesn't say anything about setting up residence. He doesn't say anything about residing there. That valley is a journey that we make. It is not the destination. Our destination ultimately is eternity. And sometimes that journey that we walk takes us through some pretty deep valleys, takes us through some pretty dark places. So how do we end up there? Well, let's look at a few options. Option number one, God sent me here. And sometimes when God sends us to a place, he sends us to a place so we can learn, or he sends us to a place so somebody else can learn. Let's look at Exodus chapter 14. Exodus chapter 14, verses 1 through 4. Page 56, if you're following along in the Sanctuary Bible. Then the Lord said to Moses, tell the people of Israel to turn back and encamp in front of Pi-Hahiroth between Migdol and the sea, in front of Baal Zephon. You shall encamp facing it by the sea. For Pharaoh will say to the people of Israel, they are wandering in the land, the wilderness has shut them in. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them, and I will get the glory over Pharaoh and all his hosts. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. And they did so. You know, that passage of Scripture is probably one of the hardest that we read in the Old Testament. Because it talks about God doing something. God hardening Pharaoh's heart so he would act. Hey, wait a minute, Jim, you talk about free will all the time. That we have the right to make our decisions, to make our choices. That is true, but God is still God. That means God is still omnipotent, that God still has the authority over all of his creation, that God is indeed sovereign, and in that sovereignty, God does have the right from time to time to violate our free will for his end and his glory. And that is exactly what the text says there. That he will get the glory. And how did the people of Israel respond? Well, let's jump down to verse 11. They aren't very nice to Moses. They said to Moses, "Is it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us in bringing us out of Egypt?" The time in the wilderness, especially in those early days, was the valley that the children of Israel had to walk through. Was it easy? No. Did God cause it to happen for a purpose? Yeah. See, here's the thing about the wilderness wanderings, or what I refer to as the longest camping trip in history. When Israel comes out of Egypt, they are a fragmented people. They've been scattered all over the land of Egypt as slaves. They are brought together. They leave as one people, but they are not one people. They have been influenced for 400 years by the gods of Egypt. We see that play out at the foot of Sinai, don't we? Moses takes a little while getting back from his powwow with God. And so what do? They make a golden calf and they start to worship it. That time in the wilderness was there for a purpose, to forge the nation of Israel into a nation. So God sent them into the wilderness. Now, it is true that their time in the wilderness was prolonged because of their own activity. See, here's the crazy thing. When God has you walk a path, He'll always be there with you. In my office, on my one of my many bookcases, there is a ship. And it is a ship that two very close friends of mine gave me for seminary graduation. One of them sitting in here this morning. And on that ship, there is a statement imprinted on the sail. And it's simply this: the will of God will never leave you where the grace of God cannot keep you. And I don't know about you, but I find that very comforting. That God may lead us on some crazy adventures, but His will will never take us to a place where His grace cannot keep us. As I said, the children of Israel messed up. They made some mistakes. And sometimes the valleys are that. The valleys are because we made a mistake. We made a bad decision. We are all guilty from time to time of self-inflicted wounds. That's where self-reflection comes in. We ask ourselves, how in the world did I get to where I'm at? And sometimes, in answering that question, you see your own reflection looking back at you in the mirror. It's kind of like here a few weeks ago when we looked at the concept of everything happening for a reason, and the reality of it is, yes, everything does happen for a reason, and sometimes that reason is that we're stupid and we make dumb choices. So sometimes that is our valley that we have to walk through. And then at other times, the answer to why am I in the valley is simply, who knows? Sometimes valleys come for reasons we can't put our finger on. Anybody know the best example of that one out of Scripture? They don't know why. It's the greatest, one of the greatest stories of suffering in all of Scripture. Job. See, we have the ability to do what Job didn't. We can read the end of the story. We know why it happened. Job didn't. He wasn't told. You know, Satan and God have this conversation. Job only loves you because you bless him. And God says, no, not at all. Job loves me because Job loves me. And so there's this challenge in the heavenly places going on. And God looks at Satan and says, okay, I will allow you to do everything short of killing the man. Job didn't understand. Job struggled. Here's what it was. Job had a sudden run of bad luck. Job didn't get it. His wife didn't get it. You know what her response was, don't you? Do you remember that? Curse God and die? If you still holding your integrity, curse God and die. Man, with friends like that, who needs enemies? And it came from his wife. And then when you looked at his friends really didn't get it. You must have done something wrong. Now, while that can be an option, it wasn't the case. But in the end, while Job struggled, and he struggled hard, he did come to understand. And he did praise God. What was recorded in the book of Job is not for Job's benefit. What is recorded in the book of Job is for our benefit. So how do we respond? Whenever we experience anything negative, our initial response is typically one of those knee-jerk reactions. This is indeed true when the valleys come our way. When considering the issue of how we will respond, there are three things that we have to keep in mind in how we respond to it. First off, the enemy is going to offer us a shortcut. You know, we're walking through that valley, and what do we want? We want to take the first exit ramp that we can see. But maybe sometimes that first exit ramp isn't the one we're supposed to take. Satan will sometimes offer us shortcuts. Jesus, to begin his ministry, goes to the River Jordan to be baptized by John. They go down into the water, down, up, and Jesus immediately leaves and goes off into the wilderness for 40 days. 40 days, 40 nights. There's something in Scripture about that number that keeps repeating itself. Continuity. But also of life. And there is Satan offering a shortcut time and time again. You're hungry? Yeah. Turn these stones into bread. Fall down and worship me and I'll give you the world. How does Jesus respond to it? How we should respond to it, but how oftentimes we don't. He responds to it by quoting Scripture. He throws Scripture. Satan throws down and he throws right back. Do not be tempted to take the shortcut. That was a challenge for me in my own situation because I knew what was happening was not biblical. That there were things that the leadership in that church was allowing, and some cases they themselves doing, that was not scriptural. I've often said that when I first got out of Bible college, I had just enough scriptural knowledge to be dangerous. And it was true. Oh, I had the head knowledge. I lacked the proper application. And proper grace. Sitting there in the office after an extremely contentious meeting with my Bible open, and I point down to the text. Why are we not doing this way? And the response was, well, we're all humans, we make mistakes. And my response to this elder, who had been an elder longer than I had been alive, that is no mistake, that is deliberate action. My words were not seasoned with grace. Oh, I was right in what I said. I didn't say I didn't understand the scripture. My danger came in the fact of application of it. Because the only one that you should ever throw scripture at like a sledgehammer is Satan. We are called to do it with grace and with mercy. Number two in this, in a self-made mess, that is a self-inflicted wound, accept the consequences. You know, God the Father loves his children, and in so he will discipline his children. It's a fact of life. Oh, we can hide stuff for a while. You know that favorite sin that we have? We can hide it for a while, but eventually it'll come out. We can put on a shiny, what we think is impenetrable veneer over our lives, but initially the cracks will begin to show. And eventually we will give an account, and we will have to face the consequences. As I've said, we have the right to make our choices. We don't get to choose the consequences of those choices. And then number three here, in a God-given task, don't run. There are times that God may ask you to do something where you look at God and go, what? Are you nuts? Just think back to Moses. Moses standing by the burning bush. And I don't know about you, I don't know how, I mean, we read the story and we look at it as a miracle of God. I would be in like Twilight Zone mindset here, folks. A bush is on fire and it is talking to me. Do we get how weird that is? How crazy that is? And not only is this bush talking to me, it's telling me to go to Egypt and lead people out of Egypt. And I'm a scaredy cat. I'm not a good public speaker. I don't know how to lead people. And so Moses gives every excuse imaginable. And what does God say? Do it anyway. I'm going to give you everything that you need to be able to do it. Again, back to the will of God not taking you where the grace of God cannot keep you. That is the providence of God. That is the care and preservation and the governing that God exercises over his creation. Now I will say this. Everything that happens in this world, is it because of the will of God or the providence of God? No, it's not. Just because God is sovereign over all things does not mean that God is first cause. Because if it was, then that would make God responsible for sin, and we just can't do that. We are responsible for our own sin and our own actions. And while we're traveling through this valley, there are several things that are required of us as Christians to keep in mind. One of them, do the right thing. While we may be tempted to act in a way that benefits us, we should always remember to keep our ethical edge about us. The second one here is, tell the truth. Even if lying would alleviate the situation, honesty is always the best option. Telling the truth is always the best option. Just because we may be able to lie and get out of it does not make that lying a good thing, or an honorable thing, or a just thing. Now, somebody pointed it out to me once, that, talking about this concept of lying, that when you look at the book of Joshua and the spy's interaction with a young lady of ill repute named Rahab, and she hid them and she lied, and she saved their lives. Did that make lying a good thing? No, not at all. It was still a lie and it was still wrong. In that case, it had a positive outcome, but you can't justify that as a good thing. Telling the truth is always the best option. Third, keep your commitments. Just because valleys begin doesn't mean life stops. I had a hard time with that one. Because when you're down and you're discouraged, you don't want to get out of bed in the morning. I had many conversations with Kim. I have to go to the office and I have to write a sermon, and I have to stand up in front of a group of people that does not want me there, and I have to preach the Word of God. And the response is, yeah, you sure do. You struggle with it. And not saying you won't struggle with it, because you will. When you're down, when you're discouraged, especially when you're depressed, it's going to be hard to put one foot in front of the other. But we must strive to do it, because if you don't put that one foot in front of the other, guess what happens? What does that valley become? That valley becomes a grave. A grave without ends. And we are stuck in it. We have to continually push forward. Also, in that valley, a concern for others. Our actions and our experiences, whether self-inflicted or thrust upon us, don't just impact us, they impact those around us. And then finally, and I think most importantly, concern for God's reputation. This is God getting the glory in all things in life. Even Job came to understand this one. Blessing God, even in the midst of the craziness. Naked I came into the world, naked I go out. I don't understand all of it, but I'm going to glorify God. Do we do that? Sometimes we do, and sometimes we don't. Or sometimes we begin by not doing it, but as we make that journey and we see how God works, then that switch flips. And we come to see it for what it is. We may not have complete understanding still to this day. In that first ministry experience of mine, I do not understand why everything happened the way that it did. And I may never get answers to that. But through it all, I did realize that God was teaching me something. That God was wanting me to learn something. And in many cases, that was many different somethings. If we view valleys as a wrong term, will never step out in faith again. When presented with a call to do so, and in the process, it will stunt our faith. So here's the point of application. Derek, I'm going to have you give me the next slide up here because my tablet decided it was going to reset itself. Application. If we run from every valley, believing that God must not be in it, we'll never experience the miraculous power of His deliverance. You do realize that a miracle needs a mess to take place. Miracles don't happen when life is good. Miracles don't happen when life isn't a challenge. Though a bad thing is always a bad thing, such experiences can and often do have a silver lining. When we consider the outcome of a valley, there are two observations to be made. Observation number one, there's always a lesson to be learned. James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. This is page 1011 if you're following along in the Sanctuary Bible. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be presented complete, may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Now, did James say that those things that you experienced were good? Definitely not, but that they can be good. Paul talks about that in Romans. That God causes all things to work for good. Not that all things necessarily are good, but God will use them for good for those that love Him. As I said earlier, though I would never want to relive that 11-month stretch early in my ministry, I did indeed learn more in that 11 months than I did in 4 years in college. and it's aided me in every subsequent ministry I've ever had. What I once viewed as an abysmal failure and something that I never wanted to talk about ever again, I've come to embrace it for what it was. And God has used it for His glory. Because even bad things, and here's the second one, even bad things can strengthen us. It wasn't easy. It took time to heal. It took time for me to process the chaos. But through it all, God was faithful. And He has carried me up until the present day. And He does that for every single one of us. God remained faithful. It was true for us. It's true for all followers of Jesus. No matter what the valley is, even when our faith is tested and we're weak, He is strong. Paul says it. Praise team, go ahead and come back up. We're going to wrap up for this morning. Paul talks about it. In those points in his life, when he is weak, that is literally when he is strong. Not because it is about him, but because it is about Jesus. It is that relationship with Christ that gives him strength. That's why Paul and Silas can make everybody around them think that they are certifiably nuts, in chains, bound hand and foot, and singing praises and giving glory to God while sitting in a stinking prison. Was that a valley? Yes. Did God carry them through it? Literally. And He does the same with us. So it brings us to our questions this morning, because it all always comes back to Jesus when you're going through that valley, but also when you're on the mountain. What are you going to do with Jesus? That first question, of course, is the question of salvation. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? If you haven't, why wait any longer? We give this invitation every week. Week in, week out. It's like, hey, Jim, do you ever get tired of giving the invitation? No. Because it's not mine. If it was, oh yeah, I'd have got tired of it years ago. But it's not mine. It is offered because we are compelled to offer it. There is never a bad time or a wrong time to come to Jesus. There is never a bad time to make that decision. Why? Because when we answer that question of eternity, of what we're going to do with Jesus, though we may not get the answers to all the other questions in life, they do fall into perspective. They give us a different perspective, a different understanding of life, and they allow us to walk through that valley of the shadow of death. Being able to fear no evil that comes against us because He's with us. And then it goes, then what are you going to do with Jesus? That's the evangelism question. Because when we walk with Jesus and we're walking through that valley, the other cool thing about that is that when we're walking through that valley, Jesus is there, but so is everybody else that He puts in our lives. We're all gathered together here as a church. We are the body of Christ in this location, planted here for God's purpose, for God's reasons. But it's not just an inward focus. Yeah, it's there, and we help carry each other, but we also help carry the communities that we call home, being the hands and feet of Jesus, and that's what we're called to do. So those are the questions this morning. What are you going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with Jesus? If there is a decision that you need to make this morning, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.
Thank you.
of my sermon. If you're taking notes, there is the takeaway for the week. You don't walk through the valley alone, even during the most intense chaos. God is still at work in you. And on that note, we will wrap up for this morning. Go ahead, reach out, grab hands with the person next to you. If you are visiting with us this morning, we're so glad that you're here and hope this morning was a blessing to you, as your presence has been a blessing to us. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day of life. We thank you for this time that we've had together here to praise and to worship and to study the fact, to help us know the fact, to impress upon our hearts that no matter what we walk through in life, we don't walk it alone, that you are there with us, guiding us, directing us, and when we are too weak to go on, carrying us, and that you put others in our lives to help us on that journey. We thank you for the journeys that we have taken, the good, the bad, the joyous, and the times of struggle. Though we may not want to relive them, may we always be grateful for the experience, for what we can derive from it. We thank you for the blessings of life, and most importantly for your son Jesus. And it's in his name we pray these things. Amen. Amen. Have a great week, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah, they just need to go on the